Hi, Charlie. Really nice to meet you. Thank you so much for your time today. Before we start, I'll just do a brief introduction. So, for our audience, you are Professor Charlie Gourley, Clinical Director of Cancer Research UK and the Edinburgh Centre, and Director of the Nicola Murray Centre for Ovarian Cancer Research. Hopefully, I got that
Yeah,
right.
that's all good. That's all good. Yes.
Good. Excellent. So Charlie, be great to kind of start off this morning and hear a little bit about your background. How did you come to be in the world of oncology and specifically why gynae oncology as well?
Yeah, okay. So I studied medicine in Glasgow, and during my medical degree, I did a what's called an intercalated BSc in genetics. So I did a genetics degree in the middle of my medical degree. And during that genetics degree, there was a lot of teaching about cancer because genes are really crucial. They've got a central role in the causation of cancer. And so it was really during that genetics degree in the middle of my medical degree that I kind of realized that I wanted to be a cancer doctor. And then, so I finished my medical degree in Glasgow. And then actually, I went up to Dundee to do my general medical training. And towards the end of that, I remember I had to call the oncologist on a Sunday because we had a cancer patient in the ward. And I said to them, I said, you know, I think I quite like this cancer thing. You know, what would you advise I do? And he said, well, you should go to, you should go and get a job in Glasgow or Edinburgh, he actually said, and train. So a job came up in Edinburgh, and I've been there ever since. But during that, well, I arrived in Edinburgh, and it was great actually because they, you know, they were so welcoming. And within 48 hours, I came across an oncologist, or they introduced me to an oncologist called Hani Gabra, who's a gynae oncologist in London, and he had a lab group here, and he was actually a senior registrar at the time, almost a consultant, but they'd given him a lab group because he was very interested in science. Like me, he'd done an intercalated BSc and he'd done a PhD, but within 48 hours, he'd sat me down and he said, this is what my lab group do. I'd really like you to do a PhD here. And so, you know, and I hadn't even really started my medical oncology training. So essentially, it was all laid out for me. I did my medical oncology training. I did a PhD with him, and he was an ovarian cancer specialist. So that really is where the interest came from. So you know, I guess a lot of it is just who you end up speaking to, and you know, this sort of which corner you turn. And so I ended up there, and you know, I really enjoy it. It seems like the right thing for me, and yeah.
And what's kind of led you to maybe specialize is the wrong word, but in your interest in low grade specifically, how's that kind of evolved?
Yeah, so again, sort of one of these things that is, it goes back a while, but it's a certain degree of serendipity about it because the another oncologist from the Marsden, Stan Kay, who's really the to a certain extent the father of gynae oncology in the UK, I think a lot of medical oncologists would say that. He, when I just become a consultant and I was interested in trials, and I was working a bit with him on other trials, and he'd made a contact in the USA with a doctor called Dr. Gershenson, who's done a lot of low-grade serous ovarian cancer research, and they wanted to set up a trial between the UK and the US, and Stan Kay suggested that I take on the role of leading from the UK side. So I ended up setting up this trial with David Gershenson. That gave me the real interest in it. By this time, I had a lab group in Edinburgh. And so we've also been working on it from the laboratory side. And, you know, that has given me a real interest. So I've ended up seeing quite a lot of low-grade serous ovarian cancer patients. I find it an intriguing disease. We still don't know as much as we should, but we're learning quickly. And the amount of research that goes on in this disease seems to grow exponentially year on year. So, you know, previously it was just a few silos. We now have got an international consortium. And that was how the interest started. And as I say, it's grown year on year, and I'm now, you know, fully invested in that, in that area.
Yes, of which we are very grateful, I think. It's really clear your point on, you know, the exponential interest in it. I think many women would say the research, the you know, the trials, the opportunities, it gives a lot of hope, I think, for women like myself. I guess that's a kind of neat segue into understanding a little bit more about some of the research that you do in this space. Could you perhaps share a little bit about that?
So a lot of it's to do with clinical trials. So obviously clinical trials are the way that we improve the therapy for a disease. We find a new treatment that we think might work, and we try and show it's better than what we've got already. But then what we can also do with these clinical trials is that we can take the tumor material that we get from the patients, and we can analyze that so that we can work out why patients that respond, and in patients that don't respond, why they don't respond. And in patients who maybe respond to start with but stop responding, what is it that's happened to that tumor at the kind of molecular level, cellular level, that has made it stop responding? So it's the integration of those two things. And then I guess the other thing about low-grade serous ovarian cancer is that because historically there's been a lot less work done on it than high-grade serous in the lab, there's still a bit of uncertainty about where the next echelon of drugs will come from. Now, don't get me wrong, there are a number of trials being set up right now, so I don't want any of your patients to think that there are not a good number of trials. But what we're doing is we're collaborating internationally, and we've brought together a number of cell line models. Actually, most of them are from a collaborator in Canada. And so these are different low-grade serous cancer cells that grow in the lab. And we are testing a large number of drugs in our lab. So we're testing almost 2,000 drugs on those cell lines in order to try and identify new agents that might be the next generation of trials that we might set up in 3 or 4 years' time, you see. So it's a question of trying to make the lab work feed into the clinic and make sure we're never in a situation where we're thinking, well, does the next clinical trial look like?
Kind of feed the pipeline almost.
Yes, exactly. So, you know, in other diseases where they're very common, perhaps pharma, you know, big drug companies, they'll have their pipeline and they'll be generating lots of drugs. It's not quite as easy as that in low-grade serous ovarian cancer because, you know, it's a smaller population of patients. But as long as it's being done in the universities and we're taking these drugs, maybe some of them may be approved for other cancers, some may not. As long as we're testing them and working out what's the next best thing for our patients.
Brilliant. And so if you had a kind of message for women who have low-grade serous ovarian cancer, what can they do to help people like yourself in the medical community to help sort of fight and get better outcomes? What can they do to support your work in the research and trial space?
Well, I think the main thing to say would be, you know, get involved in the research. You know, there is no question that clinical trials offer additional opportunities because we have a certain number of weapons that we've got in the cupboard, and the oncologists think, well, when do I want to use this weapon? When do I want to use that weapon? And very often these clinical trials are positive. And so it offers an extra bite at the cherry for the patient. It helps us because it helps us learn what's the best treatment, but also for the patient, that's a treatment that wouldn't standardly be on offer, you know, because generally speaking, they're not standard therapies, they're new therapies. Mm-hmm. So I think getting involved in trials, trying to find out where there are trials, if they're not at your centre, you know, is there a centre that your oncologist links into that can do the trials? Because there are a good number of centres around the UK that do low-grade serous trials. So I would certainly say get involved with the research. I think that is probably the main thing.
So one thing that I think is always interesting is to kind of understand what a day in the life of you looks like. Because I guess you've got kind of your patient world and looking after all of your patients, and then you've got your kind of clinical and research hat. Can you just talk us through what a typical week would look like for you?
Yeah, so I've got kind of three main jobs, because I've obviously got my patients that I look after and see in the clinic. And then I've got my lab group, and so I need to look after them and PhD students and things like that. And then I'm also the director of the clinical director of the Cancer Research Centre. So I've got to make sure that our funding is renewed and the management and strategy for that. So it does mean a bit of kind of ducking and weaving. So if I take you through a week, on a Monday, I start with my lab group meeting where I talk to the whole lab team. We make sure everybody's doing well. We make some strategic decisions. And then for the rest of Monday, it'll be meetings with collaborators and maybe funders and generally, you know, doing that sort of administration. Mm-hmm. Tuesdays, I try if possible to keep us free from meetings. So usually are some meetings creep into it, but that is really for writing papers, grant applications, whether that be for my group or for the centre. Wednesday, all day is clinic. And so it's a long day because my clinic's always overbooked. And so I do a ward round, I do my clinic, and it's all return patients I see at that clinic. And then on Thursday, some Thursdays, I have my new patient clinic where I see new patients. Mm-hmm. And then the rest of Thursday will be meeting collaborators, etc. And then Friday, again, if possible, I try not to have too many meetings, because what happens is, well, a lot of your, before the pandemic, a lot of your sort of face-to-face meetings, whether that be research committees, etc., are on a Friday. But also, if there are no meetings of that sort, again, it's important for writing papers and grants and things that you've got some blocked off time. But, you know, as you know, the world's very busy and there are many, many emails. So you've got to fit that all in and all your communication around about that. So, but that's generally speaking how the week is. I try and keep it all in silos. And it's important to say that from my clinical side, because I've got to have time when I'm not in the clinic, I have a very senior doctor, a very senior oncologist who thankfully helps me and is there for my patients if I'm not there for other reasons.
Great. And I always find it fascinating because I work in banking, so it's such a different world, but really fascinating to understand kind of all the different hats that you have to wear, I think, and, yeah, and the different roles. So thank you. Just kind of turning off a little bit. So what gives you the greatest hope in the fight against ovarian cancer and you know, for this audience, low grade serous ovarian cancer?
Yeah, so just in general, it's the fact that the science has evolved so quickly. So, you know, well, I guess it's maybe wrong to say it's evolved so quickly. As oncologists, we're getting the benefit of all the science that's happened in cancer over the last 50 years. For about 30 years, there was a huge investment in the science of cancer without really very much patient benefit. And that wasn't because they weren't doing a good job. It's just because there's such a lag phase in terms of working out how to translate that. But now we're getting the benefit of all that great science and people are getting better at working out how to put therapies into patients. And I guess in ovarian cancer, the best example is probably PARP inhibitors, mm-hmm, in high-grade serous ovarian cancer. And, you know, there's no question they've really changed the way we treat high-grade serous ovarian cancer, and they offered a huge amount of hope. And then turning specifically to low-grade serous ovarian cancer, well, we're seeing similar sort of things. So, you know, we did a study of that study that I was talking about that we set up ages ago, the trametinib study, is that, you know, it was presented about 18 months ago, and we're hopeful it's going to be published in the next month or two. So that study certainly improved the outcome for patients whose low-grade serous ovarian cancer had come back. And that study, or the rationale for that study, was based on science that had been done. And you know, I can now see signals from some of the early phase studies, the very early studies, some of which are being done at the Marsden, that show that there may be drugs coming behind, or combinations of drugs coming behind, that may be better than that. So I think in low-grade serous ovarian cancer, we've now entered that phase where hopefully we will see incremental improvements and that we'll have strategies. So, you know, I think, you know, the hope would be patients with low-grade serous ovarian cancer generally live for quite a while, which is great. It's a real positive. And our knowledge is changing during all that time, and new opportunities are arising. So you definitely should feel positive about that, and you know, and try not to, you know, try not to feel negative. Always, I would always look for the positive. That would be a suggestion to me, because you know, there is progress happening.
Brilliant. And I guess that's a really neat link into my last question. And you might sort of say that that is your advice, but what final kind of words of wisdom or what advice would you have to share with women who have low-grade serous ovarian cancer?
Well, yeah, I think stay positive is the main thing. You know, it really is. You know, for the most part, you know, it's definitely not as aggressive a disease as many, many other cancers. So there's an opportunity to, you know, make the right decision for patients with low-grade serous ovarian cancer. You don't really need to do everything at 100 miles an hour. And as I say, I believe the treatments are changing. I can see new treatments on the horizon that are extremely hopeful. And so please remember that, and try and get involved in the trials if you can, you know.
Brilliant. Professor Charlie Gourley, thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.